Hello everyone. Welcome to the White Army Comprehensive Clinical Class. The White Army is privileged to have Professor Ravindra Gadag sir, HOD of ENT from KIMS Hubli as our mentor and teacher today. A warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Ms. Pooja, third year MBBS student from MSRMC Bangalore has volunteered to present a clinical case of CSOM today. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
I welcome all the attendees to the session. With our mentor's permission, we shall begin the session.
Pooja, you can start presenting your case. All the best.
So, presenting the case of Mr. ABC, a 36-year-old male who is a farmer by occupation, hailing from Nelmangala Taluk, Bangalore Rural. He presents to the ENT OPD with chief complaints of right ear discharge since 15 years and decreased hearing in right ear since 7 years. History of presenting illness. Patient was apparently normal 15 years ago when he developed right ear discharge, which was insidious in onset, gradually progressive, mucoid in character, yellow in color, profuse in quantity. The discharge was intermittent in nature, about 4 to 5 episodes per year, each episode lasting 3 days. The most recent episode was 1 week ago, and the ear is currently non-discharging. Discharge is non-foul smelling and non-blood tinged. It is aggravated by upper respiratory tract infection and swimming in the well. The discharge has spontaneous remission in 3 to 4 days, and deafness decreases at the time of discharge. The left ear is non-discharging. A hearing loss is unilateral, only in the right ear. It is insidious in onset, gradually progressive, and is of moderate degree. Patient says he uses the other ear for telecommunication. Hearing loss decreases at the time of discharge and is non-fluctuating. There is no history of trauma to ear or ear pain, no history of vertigo, tinnitus, fever, nausea, vomiting, or any facial asymmetry as noted by patient or family members. There is no history of nasal obstruction and no history of throat pain or sore throat. Family history, there is nothing significant. Past history, there is no history of tuberculosis, asthma, epilepsy, diabetes mellitus, or hypertension. There is no history of COVID-19 infection, no history of any past ENT surgeries, and no history of use of any eardrops. Personal history, diet is mixed, appetite normal, sleep undisturbed, bowel and bladder habits are normal and regular, and there is no abusive habits. However, patient does give history of swimming in lakes, ponds, and wells.
Okay. So, 36-year-old male patient with the history of 15 years, a pretty long history of ear discharge.
Yes,
okay, so this is decreased hearing in the same years since 7 years. So ultimately, your aim of presentation is to have a proper diagnosis and an appropriate management. That is the entire thing which we are all concerned as a clinicians. So
yes,
can you go to your next slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is a mucoid character, a purulent discharge, and a profuse quantity. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
There are whatever the patient says, we take it on the face value here. It has been taught to you in your from the second MBBS that you have to tell everything in the patient's own language.
Yes, sir.
As a clinicians, we have our own questions which will arise in our mind. So, is there anything which you couldn't able to understand, or there is something which is not able to be explained based on your understanding in the entire scenario which you are seeing?
Sir, based on the history, this looks like a tubotympanic type of CSOM.
Very good.
And patient does not give any history of ear pain or anything that suggests of any complication.
What you didn't able to explain in this entire thing? Now you have mentioned it as intermittent, lasting for 3 days,
and yes, sir,
spontaneous remission. Do you think that the ear discharge will reduce on itself without any treatment?
I think with as his upper respiratory tract infection reduced, or once when he swims in the well, the water at the most will stay in the ear for a day. So beyond that, I think the aggravating factor is eliminated, and hence he is saying that the discharge is, there is no discharge that extends beyond 3 days, but the infection is most likely not cleared from the middle ear.
Okay. And now you are not supposed, now you, when you are explaining everything about the discharge here, so you are not supposed to talk about the deafness decreases at the time of discharge. That you are going to tell in your next, when you are taking your hearing loss into consideration.
Is it? Yes, sir.
So, you need not have to mention that it is understood that the left ear is not discharged.
Yes, sir.
As much as possible, try to use less negative comments in your presentation.
Yes, sir.
Go to your next slide. Okay. So now here you are going to explain about the hearing loss, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now here the hearing loss decreases at the time of discharge, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
The next sentence, what you have written is, it is non-fluctuating. What do you understand by that?
So whenever the ear is non-discharging, his hearing loss remains constant.
Okay.
So that suggests that, so when there is a fluid-filled middle ear, or in cases of Meniere's disease, due to difference in fluid volume, his hearing loss keeps fluctuating based on the fluid volume present within the ear. However, here during the time when his ear is not discharging, his hearing loss is more or less constant.
Correct. But see, hearing loss decreases at the time of discharge. And you are non-fluctuating, it becomes a fluctuating. As the ear is discharging, the patient hears better. As there is no discharge, the patient's hearing worsens.
Fluctuating means
what? There is improvement, there is deterioration. That is what you are saying it. The first sentence is hearing loss decreases at the time of discharge. And the next sentence, it is not fluctuating. No.
Yes.
It is fluctuating hearing loss. Improvement, deterioration, that you call it as fluctuating hearing loss. Are you getting what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. So go to your next slide. Okay. So now you are going to tell about your... Hello?
Yes, sir.
So now... Sorry, 1 minute. Okay. Now here you are telling your no history of ear pain or this thing. So why you have asked about history of vertigo?
In a case of middle ear infection, like in chronic suppurative otitis media, since there is effusion, the infection may cause chemical labyrinthitis, which can result in vertigo. Or he may have a coexisting inner ear pathology like Meniere's, which this may be an incident.
No. You can't have too many things. Now, everything which you are going to attribute is pertaining to this particular case only. So you are saying, considering that there is a possibility of labyrinthitis.
Yes, sir.
Put labyrinthitis as a possibility.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other possibility can produce a vertigo? In chronic suppurative otitis media, one is labyrinthitis. Any other thing will produce vertigo?
So if there is a fistula formation.
Okay, labyrinthine fistula.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So based on the vertigo, how you are going to differentiate whether it is a labyrinthitis or it is labyrinthine fistula?
Sir, we can do the fistula test.
symptoms. We are just at the symptoms. We are not gone into the examination. We are at the history level, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
And based on the history, how you are going to differentiate whether it is a labyrinthitis or a labyrinthine fistula. Isn't it? So can you consider the duration of the giddiness into account?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Tell me, what is the difference?
Sir, I think if there is a fistula present, then since the fistula is always going to be present, it will be a patent path between the middle ear and the inner ear. So it will form a connection. So the symptoms will be, the vertigo will be more frequent and it will be constant. As compared to labyrinthitis, which may decrease if the infection is controlled.
It is vice versa. So in labyrinthine fistula, you will get a giddiness which lasts for momentary. So whenever the patient moves his head, he will have a some sort of a rotation. But in case of a labyrinthitis, be it is a serous labyrinthitis or a purulent labyrinthitis, the patient won't come to the department. He will be brought to the department. That means he cannot stand on his legs. There will be continuous giddiness. So the word giddiness lasts for more than 24 hours in case of your labyrinthitis. Whereas in case of your labyrinth and fistula, the giddiness lasts for few seconds. So because you are going to suspect it and your management also depends on that. So any other complication of CSOM can produce giddiness as a symptom?
So intracranial complications.
Particular intracranial complication. Very good. So you are right. But what intracranial? Now you have got from your meningitis to brain abscess, you have got variety of complications. Out of these, which complication can produce the vertigo as a manifestation, which is also a part of balance system? Balance system, central parts which is controlling the balance also. Is your, which part of the brain is getting affected?
Cerebellum.
So cerebellum and one more area where the abscesses are common is your temporal lobe.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Out of these, the cerebellar abscesses can produce giddiness as a symptom, isn't it?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Very good. So now you have asked your fever, nausea and vomiting to rule out your intracranial complications and facial asymmetry to rule out the facial paralysis. What about the nasal obstruction and throat pain?
So they might be the etiological factors for the chronic suppurative otitis media.
So you can say that they are the predisposing factors.
Yes. Yes, sir. So they have to be corrected first before.
Okay, very good. So what else you... Okay, go to your next slide. Okay, family history is nothing significant. What else you have to add is the treatment history. In the last 15 years, has this patient has not been consulted any of the doctor for complaint?
No, sir. He said he hasn't consulted any doctor and used any drops because his discharge used to stop in 2 to 3 days.
Okay. Very good. Okay. Very good. Okay. Right. So past history is nothing significant and personal history. Go to this. Okay. So he swims in the lake. So he will have a persistent intermittent discharge. So based on your history, what is your diagnosis? Can you arrive at a diagnosis?
So it appears to be a chronic suppurative otitis media, tubotympanic type, with associated conductive hearing loss and no complications.
Okay. How you can say that it is conductive hearing loss?
Because...
associated hearing loss. You cannot...
Yes, sir.
You cannot... say that it is conductive or sensory neural hearing loss based on his history.
Yes, sir.
So, patient has got a chronic suppurative otitis media, tubotympanic. What stage is now?
Sir?
What stage of chronic?
Inactive stage, currently.
Okay, there is no discharge as such. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So without any complications and without any predisposing?
Yes, sir. No predisposing factors.
Okay. Sorry. Good, good.
So general physical examination. A 36-year-old male patient, moderately built and nourished, conscious, cooperative, and well-oriented to time, place, and person. Pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, and edema are absent. Vitals, BP 110 by 80 mm of mercury, pulse 80 beats per minute, respiratory rate 16 cycles per minute, and temperature 96 degree Fahrenheit.
Okay.
Vitals are normal. Systemic examination, CVS.
No. You have to do it the other way around.
Yes.
What for the patient has come?
So the ENT exam.
So if you, the moment when you take your stent or when you start examining his abdomen first, what he will say? No, my abdomen is in the ear. So examine that first. Okay.
So the ENT examination, examination of ear, examination of right ear, preauricular area is normal, pinna is normal, tragal sign is negative, postauricular area is normal, mastoid is non-tender, and external auditory canal is normal. The tympanic membrane of the right ear is dull and lustreless, cone of light is absent, there is a medium-sized perforation seen in the antero-inferior and postero-inferior quadrant. It is a kidney-shaped perforation, margins are smooth, there is foreshortening of handle of malleus, there are no retraction pockets or polyps seen, pars placida appears normal. This is the right tympanic membrane.
Okay.
The middle ear mucosa of the right is visible and pale. Left ear examination. The preauricular area in the left ear is normal. Pinna, normal. Tragal sign is negative. Postauricular area is normal. Mastoid is non-tender.
Ulta, you have to tell your external auditory canal. You have been taught like this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You will tell about the mastoid and then you will go to external auditory canal?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
External auditory canal is normal. Tympanic membrane. The tympanic membrane is intact. It is pearly white in color. Cone of light can be appreciated. No perforation is seen. There are no retraction pockets or polyps. And pars placida appears normal.
Okay. So here, which ear you examine first?
So right ear. Right ear was examined first.
Okay.
So middle ear mucosa is not.
What is the advantage of examining the left ear first and then go to the right ear?
So we can appreciate the tympanic membrane color and its condition in his normal ear to compare its deterioration in the affected ear.
So what is the instrument you use to examine this?
So bullseye lamp and head mirror can be used. We can use an otoscope.
Okay. So when you use an otoscope, this non-discharging ear, if you examine first, so it will avoid contaminating. If you examine the right ear first and then go to the left ear, you can contaminate the left ear. So in this case, you can examine his left ear first and then shift to the disease here.
Yes, sir.
So that there is no hard and fast rule, but this can be practiced.
Okay. Yes.
So now here, go back to your middle ear findings.
Yes, sir. Middle ear only.
Medium sized perforation. Okay. Fine. Good. Middle ear.
So can I continue?
Middle ear. Good. Go to one slide back.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So right ear. Foreshortened handle of malleus, no retraction or anything. So I told you that you are not going to talk too many no's in your.
Yes.
If it is there, you mention it. If it is not there, you need not have to tell about a negative, unnecessary. If it is relevant, then you tell it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, R flaccida is normal. That is good. So you have very nicely put your things in the examination of tympanic membrane and middle ear. What else you have to mention is there is no discharge.
Yes, sir.
That it becomes a significant thing instead of your polyps and other.
Yes, sir.
Findings. So no discharge indicates that it goes hand in hand with your history which you have written.
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. Next will be
tuning fork test.
Okay.
Also, Rinne's test is negative in the right ear and positive in the left ear. Weber's test is lateralized to the right, and absolute bone conduction test is same as examiner in both the ears.
Okay. Which tuning fork you used?
Also, 512 hertz.
Okay.
So, facial nerve is normal on both sides. And
fistula. Can you give an explanation for the lateralization of the Weber?
Sir, because if the ear is discharging or when there is a conductive hearing loss, the air conduction system is usually, there is a problem in the air conduction system. So it causes masking of the sound that enters the ear from the outside, and the bone conduction is better heard than the air conduction. And since Weber's test, we're testing mainly the air conduction in an unmasked ear, so... It will be lateralized to the affected ear because
it's basically because of the occlusion effect, what you are going to say, and your BC will be little more sensitive.
Yes, sir.
Than your the affected non-affected ear. So that is why it gets lateralized to the
affected ear. Yes.
So, can you able to quantify the hearing loss based on your tuning fork tests? Are you getting what I am trying to say?
I'm not sure, sir. I think we cannot quantify the hearing loss.
Okay. So, you cannot able to quantify. Though we tell that, okay, 256 hertz negative and 512 and 1024 hertz positive, it indicates mild hearing loss or moderate hearing loss. You are not going to quantify because you are only using a different tuning forks of different frequency.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sing it. Good. So, what are the other examinations which you have done?
So, facial nerve and fistula test was also examined in the patient.
Okay. Fine.
Next, we'll come to nose examination.
Okay.
The external appearance of the nose was normal. Cold spatula test, there was equal misting on both sides. Cotton wool test, there was equal movement on both sides. And caudal test was also normal bilaterally. The vestibule examination, tip raising test was normal on the right and left side. Anterior rhinoscopy, the septum appeared central. Floor was normal on both sides. Lateral wall was normal on both sides. Nasal mucosa was normal on both sides. Posterior rhinoscopy was not performed. And paranasal sinuses were non-tender.
Okay. Basically, your nasal examination is normal.
Normal, yes, sir.
Okay.
Examination of oral cavity. Lips were normal. Gingivo-labial sulci normal bilaterally. Buccal mucosa was normal bilaterally. Gingivo-buccal sulci were normal bilaterally. Gingiva and teeth was normal. Anterior two-third of tongue was normal bilaterally, floor of mouth normal, heart palate normal, and retromolar trigone appeared normal on both sides. Anterior pillar was normal on both sides, tonsillar fossae appeared normal, posterior pillars appeared normal, soft palate and uvula was normal, posterior pharyngeal wall was normal, there was no alteration in speech, neck, the skin of neck and neck appeared normal. The lymph nodes were not palpable and indirect laryngoscopy was not done.
Okay.
Diagnosis, right-sided chronic suppurative otitis media, tubotympanic type in inactive stage with associated conductive hearing loss and no other complications.
Okay. So this is a straightforward case of tubotympanic chronic suppurative otitis media in inactive stage.
Yes, sir.
With associated conductive hearing loss. So now how you are going to manage this particular patient?
So we can do investigations. So investigations can be done to firstly to assess the disease burden. So we have to confirm our diagnosis by examination under rotomicroscope. We can see the middle ear mucosa much more better, and the margins of the perforation can be better visualized. Audiological tests have to be done, like pure tone audiometry, and we can get an X-ray mastoid tone.
Okay. So anything else can be done when you are doing a otomicroscopy?
So if there is any foreign body or if...
Okay. So in relation to his hearing. Now, because this gentleman has come to you because he has got a hearing loss.
Yes, sir.
Can you... Now you are going to operate.
Yes, sir.
Patient, he will be undergoing a surgery. So in relation to his hearing, while doing a otomicroscopy, can you do any other thing to assure yourself and to the patient that he is going to hear better? Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Say, okay. So any test or anything you are going to do for the perforation?
Sir, we can't patch the perforation if there is, we can do a cigarette patch test to see his hearing loss. But if we do a myringoplasty, then we can't clear his middle ear infection. So we have to plan for a tympanoplasty. And under otomicroscopy, we can assess his ossicular chain status to see if and plan for the surgery.
So why can't you do a patch test for this particular patient? Any reason?
No reason, sir. But we can't do a myringoplasty for this patient at the moment.
So now, leave apart. See, when you do a otomicroscopy, for all these patients, when you are operating on a dry ear, you can do a patch test. So if the patch test shows an improvement in hearing, what you are doing by myringoplasty is just closing this perforation. This fascia. So if you do a patch test and if the patient says that he is improving his hearing, then it indicates that his ossicular chain is intact and it is mobile. So,
yes,
patient requires only a myringoplasty. If the patient says that he is not improving, with the past test, there is no improvement in hearing, it indicates that the ossicular chain is fixed, which you see in case of a tubotympanic CSOM. What is that condition called as? The end result of your chronic suppurative otitis media.
Ossicular necrosis.
Not ossicular necrosis, ossicular fixity.
Fixation.
So what is the condition which causes ossicular fixation here in case of chronic suppurative otitis media? Where you get ossicular fixation normally?
Otosclerosis.
So something sclerosis only.
What tympanosclerosis.
Tympanosclerosis. Very good. So you are going to get ossicular fixation in your tympanosclerosis. So if the hearing deteriorates following your patch test, then it indicates ossicular necrosis, what you are seeing. No? So three conditions: ossicular chain is intact, ossicular chain is fixed, ossicular chain is
necrosed.
So based on your past test, you can able to identify these things.
Yes.
What I'm trying to say, apart from your perforations and the condition, because you are not able to see your ossicles in your incus and stapes, you are not going to see with your otomicroscope.
Yes, sir.
Best thing is to do a PASS test. Very good. So that is your under your relation to your otomicroscopy. So what is the use of doing your audiometry?
So first we can quantify his hearing loss. We can get to know his nature and we can quantify his degree of hearing loss. And it can be used for pre-op and post-op comparison if to see if there is improvement. And for medico-legal cases, we have to file his audiometry because in case he has a mixed hearing loss, then we cannot promise the patient to bring back his sensory neural component post-surgery.
Okay, good.
Also, X-ray mastoid can be done to assess the pneumatization status of the mastoid. Okay. And other routine pre-op evaluation can be done, like a complete hematological profile, and an HRCT temporal bone can be done.
Okay, you want to do an HRCT of the temporal bone for your patient?
So it's not usually done routinely for tubotympanic type, but it is a mandate for an atico-antral type of CSOM. In X-ray mastoid, we can assess the sinus plate and dural plate positions, but if additional requirement is, if additional confirmation is required, we can do a HRCT of the temple.
Okay. Fine.
So the treatment will be tympanoplasty with or without cortical mastoidectomy based on the status of the mastoid.
Based on the?
Mastoid pneumatization status.
Okay. So without, you mean to say your X-ray or scan?
Sir?
So based on the pneumatization of the mastoid in the X-ray, you are going to decide whether to do a cortical mastoidectomy or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's see it. On the table, can you able to decide that whether this patient may require a cortical mastoidectomy intraoperatively?
What are
the factors to decide that this particular patient whom you are planning just a tympanoplasty may require an additional cortical mastoidectomy? What are the conditions or what are the things you look intraoperative? It is a too big question for you as an undergraduate, I can understand, but you can make an attempt. If the middle ear mucosa is thickened,
yes, sir.
If there is an ossicular chain, movements are limited, you are not getting a round window reflex, if you are finding a glue in the middle ear when you elevate the tympanometal flap. So all these things makes you to think that we may require to do a cortical mastoidectomy for this particular patient. So what do you do in cortical mastoidectomy?
So we will drill the mastoid bone at the McEwen's triangle and we will clear the disease from the mastoid antral.
Okay, very good. So can you say the boundaries of a well-formed cortical mastoidectomy?
Sir, I know the boundaries of the McEwen's triangle.
Okay. So McEwen's triangle, can you tell it?
So the McEwen's triangle, superior boundary is the inferior temporal line. Antero-inferior boundary is the Henle spine of the tympanic bone, and the postero-inferior boundary is the tangent between the two boundaries will form the postero-inferior boundary.
Okay, so the one line is the posterior-superior canal wall, the bony external auditory canal. So why you will be selecting this particular area only?
So the mastoid antrum lies 1.25 to 1.5 centimeters beneath the McEwen's triangle. So it is easy access to the mastoid antrum.
Okay. Why you have to do at this particular place only? Any idea? Why only you have to identify the mastoid antrum? What exactly is this mastoid antrum?
So it is the biggest mastoid air cell.
Okay. It is the largest.
It connects with the middle ear via the adytes.
Okay, can you tell the other air cells of the mastoid?
So I'm not sure.
Okay, so you have got around the mastoid antrum, you have got periantral cells. Then you have got around the facial nerve, perifacial air cells. around the labyrinth. You have got perilabyrinthine ear cells, sinodural cells, zygomatic ear cells. So they are named according to the position where they are.
Yes, sir.
So that gives you an X-ray of honeycomb appearance, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Out of all these ear cells, why do you select to do a mastoid antrum only? Why not you can consider to open at the zygomatic ear cells? Why not we can consider to open at their tip cells? Is because the mastoid antrum is always present.
Yes, sir.
Whereas the other cells, may be sclerosed.
Yes, sir.
And from that area, you start widening your mastoid cavity. Okay. So, a well-formed cortical mastoidectomy will have the superior border will be your tegmental entry.
Yes, yes.
So, and posteriorly, what do you have?
Sinus plate.
Posteriorly, you have got a sinus.
Sinus plate.
Anteriorly?
Posterior wall of external auditory canal.
Very good. So, it is the posterior bony wall.
Yes, sir.
Cartilaginous wall. And inferiorly, it is the?
Mastoid tip.
Very good. And medially?
So, the medial wall of the middle ear and mastoid.
Not middle ear, we are in the
mastoid.
Medially, it is the bony labyrinth.
Yes, sir.
So, these are the boundaries of a well formed cortical mastoidectomy.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, do you know any other non infectious diseases where we do a cortical mastoidectomy?
So, if the mastoid hair cell system is sclerosed, it can be done.
No, no. Non-infective indications for mastoidectomy. This is an infective indication, isn't it? So,
yes.
Do you have any non-infective indications for?
Sir, in Meniere's disease for endolymphatic sac decompression, we will.
Very good. Very good.
Mastoid.
Yes.
It can be done to approach to the posterior or middle cranial fossa.
Very good. Very good. Okay. Abdul has told in the chat box about what is the treatment for your sensory neural hearing loss, the profound sensory neural hearing loss, what surgery you are going to do?
So, cochlear implant?
Yeah, very good. So, cochlear implant is also done transmastoid. So, what
yes,
approach you do there is?
So, we go through the facial recess area and insert the cochlear implant through the round bend.
Okay, sing it. So, that is a good one. Sing it. So, what is the graft material you use in case of your plasties?
So temporalis fascia graft can be used.
Okay. So what is the, can you tell the reasons?
So firstly, the temporalis fascia can be excised through the same incision. The same postaural incision can be used. It is a large fascia.
Okay. Okay. Good.
So, and it has a low basal metabolic rate.
Okay. It's that should come first.
Yes, sir.
So your answer should be in an order of preference. So, the low basal metabolic rate, the same incision, the thickness is that of
tympanic membrane.
What are the other graft materials we use?
So, we can use the fascia lata. We can use tragal cartilage.
Okay.
We can use the perichondrium.
Yeah, perichondrium you use.
Yes, sir.
So, where you use cartilage, preferably, do you have any idea where we do a cartilage tympanoplasty?
I'm not sure, sir.
In case of your adhesive otitis media, we do because you don't want the graft to be once again getting retracted because of the tubal dysfunction.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Do you have any idea about the different materials for osteoclastic?
So we can use artificial prosthesis can be used for osteoclasty.
Okay.
Can you... Teflon prosthesis, total osseocular replacement prosthesis can be used.
Okay, good.
Or so depending on which ossicle is involved, if the only the stay piece is involved, then we can use only a stay piece. Head or Teflon piston can be used if stay piece with the
titanium, the material which common
titanium.
So Teflon is usually used for your
photosclerosis.
Okay, here you use a titanium prosthesis, or what are the other materials which we can use? Is the cartilage. We can use the tragal cartilage. We can use the autologous ossicles. Okay.
Yes,
so, sir. Can you now tell about the different types of tympanoplasties?
Yes, sir. So the types of tympanoplasty, we have six types of tympanoplasty. Type according to Wild's classification. And the first type of tympanoplasty is the same as myringoplasty, where the graft is placed over the malleus. Type 2 tympanoplasty, the graft is placed over the incus. In type 3 myringoplasty, the graft is placed over the stay piece. So there is, since there is only one ossicle left, it is called myringostepidopexy or columellar tympanoplasty. In type 4 tympanoplasty, the graft is placed over the oval window. Right. Or the oval window is left patent and the graft fills the rest of the medullary mucosa. And in type 5 tympanoplasty, it is a fenestration operation where a fenestra is made on the lateral semicircular canal. Type 4 and type 5 tympanoplasties are no longer done. And type 6 tympanoplasty is sonoinversion, where the oval window is fixed and a fenestra is made on the round window to maintain phase difference.
Okay, very good. What are the different types of myringoplasty, you know?
So we have two techniques of myringoplasty, underlay technique and overlay technique. So in underlay technique, the graft is placed under all the three layers of the tympanic membrane, but in front of the malleus. And overlay technique, only the epithelium of the tympanic membrane is raised and the graft is placed on top of the fibrous layer.
Okay. Very good. So what is interlay? Have you heard about the interlay myringoplasty?
No, sir.
Okay, you will be elevating your outer epithelial layer and the middle fibrous layer, and the graft is placed over the
mucosal
layer. So, and they say nowadays that is the most physiological grafting technique.
Yes, sir.
What are the approaches you do it for this? What are the different approaches?
So based on the incisions, we can have a post-auricular modified William Wild's incision.
Okay.
We can have Lempert's end-oral incision at the incisura terminalis.
Okay.
Or we can have an endomeatal incision.
Very good. Very good. Okay. So, under which anesthesia you do?
So, usually it can be done under local anesthesia.
Okay.
A tympanoplasty can be done under local anesthesia.
Okay.
So, general anesthesia may be required if you're dealing with some complications or...
Okay. What is the local anesthetic agent used?
So, xylocaine.
It is right. What percentage of xylocaine you?
I'm not sure.
Okay. Have you seen any cases of ear surgery being operated?
So I've not a tympanoplasty, but I've seen a cortical mastectomy.
Okay. So what is the advantage of local anesthesia over general anesthesia? Do you have any? I think it is a little bit.
So in So when local anesthesia is given, we can assess hearing almost immediately post-op. We can assess the hearing on table.
That's good.
And all the complications of general anesthesia are
avoided.
Are avoided if a local.
Okay. So, whom you select to do it under general anesthesia? Apart from the patient who is apprehensive, what is the most important thing which is required to do a patient under local anesthesia?
So, patient has to be cooperative.
That is one thing. This patient is cooperative.
So, he...
No, because you are going to deal with a micro surgery. The patient should have, what is the most important requirement is that you should be in a position to communicate with the patient.
Yes, sir.
You should be knowing the language which you are going to speak, because you require the patient's cooperation, especially when you are dealing with the ossicles. When if at all you are doing any drilling, the patient should not move his head. So if he is from Tamil Nadu or if he is from Kerala and you are a Bangalore girl who doesn't know the Malayalam, so you cannot able to communicate. In those patients, you take the patient under general anesthesia so that the patient will be calm and quiet and you will do your procedures. But as you have mentioned, the hearing assessment on the table will be difficult. But since you have got the other modalities of assessing, like post-op audiogram and all, it will be of assessing it. What are the complications can occur while you are operating?
So we can cause any injuries to any of the surrounding structures during surgery.
Like?
So while raising the tympanomeatal flap, the tympanic membrane may be injured. The remaining of the tympanic membrane may be injured.
Okay.
So by mistake, when we are in the middle ear cavity trying to clear the infection, we may accidentally cause a fenestra on the middle wall. The oval window has
commonly, to be- commonly. Now you have to be, you are facing an exam. So you have to be telling the common ones first.
So facial nerve resection can be
facial nerve resection. What is
facial nerve injury by
okay. Any other nerve which is a branch of facial nerve can be
corda tympani.
Corda tympani. Most commonly the nerve to be injured is corda tympani. Then you may injure the ossicles. There may be an accidental ossicular
displacement.
And the yes, as you have mentioned, there may be a tear in the posteromeatal flap, which you are going to raise. So while doing a mastoidectomy, what are the complications can occur?
So in case the sinus plate or dural plate positions are we're unaware, then we may damage the dural plate and reach the brain, or we may damage the sinus plate. And since the sigmoid sinus lies right behind the sinus plate, it can cause profuse hemorrhage.
Okay, good. Then?
So if we drill the mastoid too deep, then we can cause a fistula by drilling into the bony labyrinth.
Okay, good. And
facial nerve can be injured at its exit in the stylomastoid foramen.
Not at the stylomastoid foramen. At the vertical
part.
So by iatrogenic facial palsy, which part is common is?
Vertical part of
facial. Vertical part. By the disease, which is more common is?
Horizontal part.
Horizontal part of the facial nerve. Very good. So what are the advantages of your local anesthesia when you are doing this mastoidectomy under mastoidectomy under local anesthesia is?
Even facial nerve function can be assessed.
Facial nerve functions can be assessed. And if you are drilling near the labyrinth, what the patient will complain?
Vertigo, dizziness.
So intraoperatively, if the patient is complaining of vertigo, then you think that, okay, you will be knowing that you are drilling near the labyrinth. you will be cautious. These all advantages will be lost when you are doing it. These mastoidectomies under
general anesthesia.
Okay, that's very good. What are your preoperative medications which you give for a local anesthesia? What is the sedation which you use? What is the protocol in your hospital?
So I'm not too sure, but okay. I think preoperative medication that we have to give, I think we have to first clear the wax. So we might give him wax dissolving drops. Okay. And if he has any...
You have already examined, there is external auditory canal is clear. So now you are posted the patient for a surgery. So intraoperatively or preoperative preparation or preoperative medications, if you are doing, what is the most important thing they give is sedate the patient.
Yes, sir.
Usually, when you are not going to sedate too much the patient because you want the patient's cooperation, usually midazolam is usually give, or they give a fortin and panargal. So now earlier it is the surgeon used to give. Now we for every patient they will have a standby anesthetist, and the anesthetist, even if you are operating under local anesthesia, the sedation part is taken care by the anesthetist. What is the post-op management for these patients?
So regular follow-up has to be done.
What are the medications you give? What are the medications?
So we can give analgesics has to be given to the patient.
What analgesics you give?
So I think NSAIDs or paracetamol can be given as an analgesic because we have done.
Okay. How much you give paracetamol?
So I'm not sure.
What is the basic problem of the students? What we have seen, it's not only you, it is the entire students community who come to us. When in the examination, we are going to ask the same thing. What is it? Because your previous students have told all these things, the mastoidectomies, the tympanoplasties, the graft things. Are you going to do a surgery? No, the seniors will do it. But what you are going to do, definitely you are going to manage post-operatively. You are the one who is going to give an antibiotic. You are the one who is going to give an analgesics. You are the one who is going to give an antiemetic. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
But what is the problem is that you are not going to be considered yourself as a part of the treating team. See, you are a treating team part only. Then only you will be going and seeing what is the pre-medication they are giving. Here what happens is the interns will give, the postgraduates will give, you will go with your bag and stand and finish the surgery or finish your clinical postings and go back. You will not be seeing the case sheet, what they have written. Isn't it? It's a universal. I'm not saying that what you have done a wonderful presentation. I'm really, really happy. But until and unless you become a part of the treating team, this part which you are going to manage will be lost. And in the examination, invariably everybody will be asked because you have passed your pharmacology. So they will be asking you about the dose. They will be asking you about the duration, how many days you are going to do, give. Then when you are going to change the dressing, okay, you have done a mastoid dressing. So when you are going to change the mastoid dressing, these are all because they are not doing assessing a theory. Theory you have finished. It is a practical. What you are giving in the after your theory is practical. So practical questions only they will be asking. So how you are going to manage the patient post-operative? Usually we give a course of antibiotic. What are the antibiotics which every hospital has got their own way, their own protocol. Commonly used antibiotics, which usually we give, is amoxicillin with clavulanate, or a second generation or a third generation cephalosporins, like in the form of cefadox and amproxetil. So how many days we give? Usually we give for a period of 1 week, isn't it? Along with that, you give an antihistaminic. Since the patient will have tendency to develop the ear problems because of the upper respiratory tract infection, some people have the habit of giving an antihistaminic. It is not mandatory, but usually analgesics and antibiotics for a period of week or so.
Yes.
The dressing you usually done on the second post-operative day. So what is the suture material used? Do you have any idea?
So anybody, dissolvable sutures are used.
Yeah, you can use your Vicryl
30.
60 Vicryl. Yeah, 30 Vicryl they use. Or some people use a non-absorbable sutures also. And the sutures, when you are going to remove the sutures, if at all you have put a non-absorbable sutures, preferably 7 days. So when you are going to, the patient will be curious to know whether what surgery you have done is proper or not. So when you are going to do your audiogram, so usually 3 to 4 weeks later, you are going to do the audiometric examination. But the advice you are going to give the patient is that
try your precautions.
Precautions. What precautions is not because its graft is there, it is here. Now he can he able to swim or he cannot able to swim?
Not until.
Okay, once it is healed, he says that after 6 months, can I able to swim, doctor? He can swim. There is a drum which has been, you have done a proper job and it is healed. So each patient can able to do all the water sports and other things. But only thing what he has to be advised is that any upper respiratory tract infections has to be managed aggressively so that he doesn't develop the reinfection. Isn't it? So yes. That's the entire idea. So now we will just, can I, Kriti?
Yes, sir.
Pooja has really done very well. She has really read well and prepared a nice presentation. And she is very confident with her answers. This is what we require from the students. Absolutely flawless presentation. Can I share my screen? I just want to show the students about the small middle ear things. And just want to have a little bit of, can I share my screen?
Sure, sir.
So this is a small, video which we have to show that how the perforations and all can be. This is an otoendoscopy. This is transcanal meningoplasty. This is how we take an incision. So this is what she was mentioning about the injury to the posterior canal wall skin, tympanomeatal flap. So this is the tympanomeatal flap, and we have raised the tympanomeatal flap, and you can able to see the underlying ossicles. See, this is Pooja, this is what I was telling. This is, what is this nerve?
Corda tympani.
That is your corda tympani. So what is this area where my cursor is there? My
sir, round window.
Yes, very good. So that is your round window. So what is this structure?
Sir, I'm not sure.
That is your stapedius tendon.
Stapedius.
Mm. Okay. And you can see that incus and the stapes also. And now you can see that movement of the ossicles when you are, that is your malleus. And now I am moving my malleus, and you can appreciate so concentrate on this round window area, and when I move my malleus, you can able to see the movement here. Can you able to appreciate it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this indicates that ossicular chain is intact and mobile. So this is about to show you the middle ear cavities, and so this is about. I think we have done with Pooja, and any other questions anybody has?
So there are no questions on YouTube or Zoom, so as of now.
Okay.
Yes. So any concluding remarks?
For all the undergraduate students of this particular branch. Now, what is the difficulties faced by undergraduate? Can you tell me, Pooja, what are the difficulties faced by you in ENT?
Sir, the subject is easy to understand when taught, but we don't see too much of procedures. So
this is because as an undergraduate, you will not be able to appreciate the structures with your headlight, isn't it?
Yes,
as in case of when you go to medicine or when you go to your surgery, you will be having your stethoscope and appreciate your heart sounds or your respiratory sounds. And when you go to surgery, you can palpate your abdomen and say that liver is enlarged, spleen is palpable, mass is there. So here, entire perception of your identifying the pathology is by visual impressions only. To say that it is hypertrophied or whether it is normal, you should have seen the normal structures. So which till you come for a clinical postings, we have not seen them because everything is hidden. And to visualize this, you require a proper illumination and the proper gadgets. So with your headlight, what all you can able to appreciate only up to the vestibule of the nose, or at maximum anterior rhinoscopically, you can able to see the turbinates. The only thing which you can able to see is your throat. By depressing the tongue, you can able to see your tonsils and the posterior. In the ear, you cannot able to appreciate anything other than an external auditory canal. Some of the postgraduates will tell, or the junior faculty will tell, and you will be able to tell the same thing repeatedly to others in the examination or in your clinical presentation. What I mean to say is try to identify, use the PG's otoscope. tried to be present in the theater and asked the faculties to show their structures. Only when you see the normal structures, you can able to understand what is abnormal there. When we say an inferior turbinate hypertrophy, you should have seen few normal things. Then only you can say that this is hypertrophy. To say it is normal or a retracted tympanic membrane, you should have seen at least 10 normals. Then only you can see what is retracted. So what I mean to say is, try to be more present in the clinics. So not just presentation, you have to identify the pathologies. Try to examine by yourself. So either by examining your own colleagues to say the normal structures, or in the OPD, try to catch few of the patients, ask their postgraduates or the junior consultants to take their help, how to hold. Majority of you people doesn't know how to hold the nasal speculum only. So only if you practice, you can able to identify. Whether you become an ENT surgeon or not is completely different, but you have to enjoy the postings which you have been posted. And you can enable to feel proud, okay, I can able to diagnose on myself without anybody's help. So that should be your attitude. And you, this is a nice way that you people are conducting the teaching activities. I thank White Army for giving us a platform to discuss our views pertaining to ENT topics. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
It was wonderful discussion. It was very useful to us. Thank you, Professor Ravindra, sir, for taking your time and joining us for this wonderful discussion. We could learn a lot from you. We also thank for the informative video. It was great presentation by Ms. Pooja. We could learn a lot from her well-prepared presentation. Thank you. Thanks to all the participants for your active participation. Thank you, one and all.